Good morning, church. Michael, we're glad to have you here with us again today. Jan is going to be back from her vacation next week, so we'll be glad to have her back as well. For all of those who are gathering virtually, I invite you to fill out our contact card and you can give us information on your prayer concerns that way so that we can pray for you. The link to that card is in the post on Facebook and on YouTube. Our announcements this morning. In your bulletins, you've got an envelope for the reconciliation offering. We'll be collecting that the next 2 weeks. But if you want to go ahead and do it this week, that's fine too. So reconciliation offering, you'll hear more about that next week. The trustees are not meeting. Is that correct, Ken? Okay. Okay, we have canceled a meeting. Yay, team! No sense meeting when we don't need to. The trustees have been working so diligently on everything and trying to vet some of the opportunities for the church, and we really appreciate what you do. The prayer group is meeting tomorrow at 1, and our Bible study is beginning again at 2 o'clock. We are going to be studying the book of Exodus. If you've not been in the Bible study group before and would like to receive the information for that, please let me know and I'll add you to the list and send you all of the information. this week is a board meeting week. Our elders will be meeting on Thursday at 5:30, and then the administrative board meets at 6:30. We've received word from Billy Walker's family that they would like to postpone her memorial service, which was scheduled for this Saturday. I'll keep you apprised of the updates on that service as we have those. And finally, our item for concern this month is ramen noodles. So you've still got a couple more weeks to do those. Are there other announcements? Okay. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Please rise for our call to worship.
Happy are the people
who do not follow the advice of the wicked,
or take the path they follow,
or sit in the seat of scoffers.
Their delight is in the law of the Lord,
and they meditate on God's law day and night.
The Lord watches over the way of the righteous,
but the way of the wicked will perish. We will set our feet on the righteous path of God. We've come to our time of joys and concerns, our time of prayer. I will say, God, in your mercy, following each one, and you will respond, hear our prayer. Are there joys and concerns that you would like to share today? Suzanne, how's your nephew? Okay, and he's in Tulsa. Okay, Suzanne's nephew has had both of his surgeries, and he's still in the hospital recovering. God, in your mercy. Yes, Kim. God of joy. Oh, great. Oh, and happy birthday. Tomorrow. Welcome. We're glad to have you. Okay, from... Wamego. W-O-M-E-G-O. Okay. Welcome. Where in the world in Kansas is that?
It's just outside of Manhattan.
Okay. You're the one who's up there. Okay. Outside of Manhattan. Welcome. It's good to have you with us. And Sharon has a birthday. It's a big birthday. Yes? Coming up tomorrow. So we'll give you an advance happy birthday. Okay, Sarah. Okay, prayers for her sister and her husband and cousin who all have COVID. God in your mercy.
Susan?
Yes.
Have a prayer and a joy, I guess, combined. Rita's mom tested positive for COVID. She was doing fine. Yesterday we got a call. They had to take her to the ER because her blood pressure and heart rate were extremely high. They were able to get that under control pretty quickly, and she took the infusion of the COVID antibodies, and within probably 4 or 5 hours, she was back at the nursing home. So she seems to be doing fine. But we had a little scare yesterday.
Okay, that was Rita's mother, and she's in Kansas, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, Rita's mother, who has COVID, but is doing pretty well. God in your mercy. I want to offer sympathy to Carl and Harriet Johns. Carl's daughter, Amber Preble, passed away Wednesday in Bixby. Her visitation is tomorrow evening, and her service is Tuesday at 2 p.m. Both of those things are in Bixby. God in your mercy. Let's go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come to you with hearts that need to be open to your word and to your love. Keep us ever mindful of your presence and the hope that you've given us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Guide us, we pray, as your church in our mission to spread the good news. Keep us focused on the mission and the ministry to which you've called us, and lead us forward. We know that we have further yet to go on our way together with you. There have been bumps and holes in the road, and we know that there will be more ahead. But save us from dwelling on them and focus us on the goals that you've placed before us. Hear our prayers for all who need healing in their lives, for those that we have named today and those that we name before you each day, and also those who are known only to you in the depths of our hearts. These are our prayers, and we offer them to you in the spirit of Jesus, who said, "Not my will, but thine be done." And in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Thank you.
Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 9, verses 30 through 37. They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." May God add blessing to the reading and the hearing of these holy words of Scripture. It's been quite a while since I've seen a movie, since I've been to a movie, and I really miss that experience, from the surround sound and the big screen to the popcorn. For Chris and me, the theater has always been our go-to entertainment. One movie that's not in theaters right now that I'd like to see again is called The Way. The Way. It's got Martin Sheen, Emilio Estevez, and Deborah Kerr in it. The Way is a movie about pilgrimage, and the tagline that's listed on the movie poster is this: "Life is too big to walk it alone." The setting for The Way is in France. It's along the Camino de Santiago, the Way of St. James. The trail winds its way through the Pyrenees Mountains. Martin Sheen plays Thomas Avery. Now, Tom is an American ophthalmologist who goes to the Camino de Santiago to retrieve the body of his son, who had just died on the trail in a snowstorm. Tom's initial intent was just to go up there, retrieve the body, and come back. But that changes. Tom decides that he wants to walk this ancient spiritual trail all the way to its conclusion in Spain, in memory of his son. On the Camino, Tom meets many other people from around the world. Everyone is looking for greater meaning in their lives. There's a large man from Amsterdam who says that he's walking to lose weight to get ready for his brother's wedding, and also he hopes that his wife would desire him again. And Sarah, a Canadian fleeing from an abusive husband, she's walking the Camino, she says, to quit smoking. And there's Jack. He's an Irish travel writer with writer's block who wants to write that novel that he dreamed of writing when he was younger. They walk, and they talk, and they piece together the realization that was spelled out on that movie poster. Life is too big to walk it alone. That we need each other. That we learn and grow more when we're with each other. And that life is nothing if not a pilgrimage, a sacred journey. In Mark's gospel, the way to discipleship and also to faith is found in the journey. It's a trip that Jesus and the disciples physically take together, as well as spiritually. And it's the same that we walk today. It's the same journey. And if we're doing it right, we're going to walk together. And we walk it in the way of Jesus. As Jesus and his disciples move from place to place, Jesus does his level best to explain to the disciples who he is, what his mission is, and what he's about, and probably more importantly, what it means to be a follower of the way. There's just one problem. In terms of understanding, the disciples are generally 3 steps behind Jesus, or they're running ahead of him, miles ahead on spiritual rabbit trails. They're physically all on the same path, but they're often miles apart in understanding. Of all the gospel writers, Mark is the one who is the hardest on the disciples. He paints a pretty bleak picture of them. Mark tells of not one time, but three times when Jesus explains to the disciples patiently what's going to happen to him, that he's going to be handed over, tortured, die a horrible death, and then on the third day, rise. Last week we read the first account, and this week we read the second account in Mark 9. The disciples hear Jesus tell them that things aren't going to end well, and as we might expect, they don't understand. Or they don't seem to understand. But I've got sympathy for them. Think about what happens when we receive bad news. Sometimes our minds shut down in denial. They leave us saying, well, this can't be true. That doesn't jive with what I thought. Sometimes we stop listening because we simply can't bear to hear something that we don't want to hear. When we get an unfavorable diagnosis, isn't it common for us to think, I don't understand? Often we're so stunned that we either can't ask questions or we don't because we're afraid of what the answers might be. I think we should cut the disciples a little bit of slack with that news that they just received. I wonder how I might have reacted in that same situation. So I'm glad that Mark shows us a group of men who were so very human that they reacted in a way that I might have. It strengthens my confidence as a disciple to know that Jesus picks and picked ordinary people to follow him, ordinary people like us, to be what God intends us to be, and that Jesus had the confidence that we had the capability to fulfill the mission. So the disciples are confused. They don't ask for clarification, and they quickly begin to lose their way. They begin talking about the most ridiculous thing in light of the news that they've just heard. They essentially change the subject as soon as they think Jesus is out of earshot, and a debate ensues about who among them is the greatest disciple. They must have been mortified when Jesus came back and they realized that he had heard them. He asked them what they were talking about. It's like when the teacher walks back into the classroom and you've done something that you shouldn't have done, and the students realize that they've been caught. Instead of asking who will be the greatest or who is the greatest, they should have been asking, what kind of Messiah are you? What makes you, as the Messiah, want to take up the cross, to go even unto death? Why in the world would you allow yourself to be humiliated like that? But those questions may have been too hard for them, maybe too frightening to ask. We know that people in Jesus' day expected the Messiah to be powerful, to be a military Messiah, one who was powerful enough to conquer with military might coupled with divine wrath. In that scenario, what the disciples were discussing would have made sense. They're asking, essentially, who would be Jesus' highest ranking officer in this new empire that he was creating. But we know what the disciples didn't. We know that Jesus didn't plan to take over the government. We know that he planned to take over the hearts and the minds and the spirits of the world. A Messiah who would die instead of fighting would certainly be an embarrassment to the disciples, wouldn't it? Even after the crucifixion for decades to follow, the early Christians still wanted to explain away Jesus' death. There was one group called the Docetic Christians. They even believed that Jesus didn't really suffer and die. They thought that Jesus' physical body was a paranormal phenomenon, to use our terms, and that Jesus was 100% divine. His suffering and his death, they reasoned, was just an illusion. Or if Jesus did die or did suffer, the Docetic Christians held that only the human part of Jesus suffered, that the divine part was left untouched. Well, it took about two centuries after Jesus died for this belief to be called heresy by the church. It's amazing some of the gymnastics we go through, the mental gymnastics that we go through to make things jive. Amy Oden of Wesley Theological Seminary suggests that the disciples and the early Christians needed an almighty God who conquers enemies, not one who suffers and dies. She continues, such a self-demoting God could hardly be trustworthy. It's hard to trust power that comes from weakness. I don't think we're very much different now. Our own assumptions about Jesus and God's purposes for us still lead us to ask the wrong questions or even try to come up with a better answer. The cross isn't any easier for me to explain today than it was for them to explain back then. There was a minister who, before realizing his calling, went off and joined the Coast Guard. He found himself in boot camp, and he was expected to learn how to shoot. This man had never shot a gun in his life, let alone held one. And he was surrounded by guys who bragged endlessly about their skill and how they had been shooting ever since they were young. The man began learning to shoot, and to his surprise and to the surprise of the others around him, he was pretty good. He wasn't perfect. He was not the best in the group, but he was good. His instructor pulled him aside and said, I can tell you've never shot before. And the man asked him how he could tell, and the instructor replied, because you had no bad habits to unlearn or ego to overcome. You were open and ready to learn from me, a clean slate. One of the most challenging things for us to do as thoughtful adult Christians is to unlearn any of our own bad habits or misguided beliefs so that we can walk on the actual way of Christ. Many of us grew up believing that God was something like a genie granting wishes for the faithful. And I think there are times when we still yearn for that. We want a God who will right all of our wrongs and vanquish every ill, every problem that we encounter. Let my will be done, not let thy will be done. Or we may try consciously or unconsciously to simply buy our way into God's graces. Now, tithes and offerings are important, but so is service, even of the smallest kind. Our time is one of our most valued possessions. We may think that we don't have the time or the energy for service, but it is there for almost all of us if we want it to be, if we believe that it's important. Jesus told the disciples the hard truth about living the Christian life. If you travel this way with me, it will be hard. There will be questions that you're too afraid to ask. There are things that you're not going to want to do. And most of all, you will extend welcome to everyone, to the outsiders, to those who are not in your social and economic circles, and to those that you might not even give a second look at on the street. People like that child that we just read about, that child that Jesus asked us to welcome. Folks, welcoming a child would have been much more difficult for the disciples than it should be for us. Children had no status in that time and in that place, and they were often seen as a burden until they were old enough to contribute economically to the family. Well, consider what we know about children even today. They are unemployed and penniless. Children are naive and uneducated. They can often be grimy and rude, and they have no power. Jesus says that when we invite people like this, naive, uneducated, no jobs, no power, grimy and rude, when we invite them into our lives and our churches, serving them rather than asking them to serve us, Jesus says that we are welcoming God. Walking the way is difficult, and I think we need to stop from time to time to make sure that we're on the right path. One of the clues that we might not be on the right path is that it seems too easy, just a little bit too easy to be true. We need to ask ourselves, are we following Jesus' way or are we following our way? Jesus' way almost always requires more of us, our time, our talents, our resources, sometimes more than we think that we'll be able to give. And still we are called. Where is God asking you to go? Where is God asking us to go? What is God asking this church to do? Even in this difficult time, in this congregation, we can serve. We can help disaster victims. We can learn how to make life better for the refugees who are in our midst now and for the refugees who surely will come to this community. We can do that. We can continue our ministry in Christ to those who are hungry and homeless or poor, and not just to those in Bartlesville, but around the world. This congregation has a bold and long history of supporting the church's wider mission and its missionaries. The least of those are all around us. And if we can't see them, or if we don't know how to welcome them, our best answer is first to start with God, and then to look to the others who've walked this journey before us, and then finally to work with those who are on this journey with us today. On the Camino and in real life, life is too big to walk it alone. And we don't have to. We have Jesus, and we have the whole community in Christ. Thanks be to God. Whatever our struggles, whatever our miracles, whatever our burdens, and wherever that way of Jesus takes us, we are thankful for the blessings that we've received from God and from God's good creation. Let us now dedicate our tithes and our offerings, all of these gifts. Please rise for the doxology. James chapter 4, verse 8 reads, "Draw near to God, who will draw near to you." And that's why we're here at this table. We're here to draw near to God so that God will draw near to us. Do you remember the first table that you gathered around to have your first communion? Maybe it was even this table. Maybe it was a table in some city far, far away. Think about all the tables that you've gathered around. Some may have even been in other countries, many with Christians that we had never met before. Wonderful experiences, but the one thing that they have in common, they have bread and cup, all offered as we seek to be reconciled with God, all surrounded by people who seek the way of Christ. Shall we pray?
Gracious God, we thank you for this day and everything in it. We thank you for all the gifts you give to all of us. We thank you for the gift of family and friends to share our lives with, for the beauty of the earth, and for the fellowship we share in this place. We thank you most of all, Father, for the gift of your Son and our Savior, Jesus. Father, as we come to your holy table at this time, in this place, we're reminded of Christ's life, his teachings, his death, and his resurrection to eternal life, so that we may all have eternal life. We're reminded that Jesus paid the price for our sins through his death on the cross, and that he broke the bonds of death when he rose again. As we share this bread, we share his body broken for us. As we share this cup, we share his blood poured out for us. Father, forgive our sins, and we pray that you help us walk closer with you and your Son each day. These things we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. On the night that Jesus gathered in the upper room with his disciples, he took a loaf of bread, and giving thanks to God, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he shared it with his disciples. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And later in the meal, he took a cup, poured it, and giving thanks to God once again, he said, "This cup is the covenant renewed in my blood. Each time that you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, remember me until I come again." The table is set. Gather round. I've never been on a pilgrimage like the one to the Camino de Santiago. I would love to go. I think that would be a marvelous experience to combine going someplace majestic like that and walking with people on the way and talking, really getting to know our fellow travelers. I guess that's what we do every day in our lives now, though. We walk with each other, we walk with Christ, and we learn a little bit along the way. Won't you rise and sing our hymn of dedication?
Amen.
into the world walking the more excellent way, walking with Jesus, seeking to serve, seeking to welcome even the lowliest child that you meet. Go in peace. Amen.